I am now going to introduce the first section of our presentation, an introduction to the EIA action. AISA is in the process of developing a reference architecture for classifying and organizing the most silent building blocks relevant to interoperability used in the delivery of digital public services. This means that the key focus of this AISA action is the interoperability, meaning that the action doesn't want to create a full-fledged enterprise architecture, reference architecture, and the delivery of digital public services, meaning that the focus of the reference architecture is on the users and the providers of digital public services. In this slide, I present the main work products of the EIA action. The two member products are the EIRA, the European Interoperability Reference Architecture, which is a five-view reference architecture for delivering digital public services across borders and sectors, and the EIA CART, a mapping of solutions to the building blocks of the EIRA. This means that the EIRA is focusing on the architecture side, on the architecture space of the designing of a trans-European system, and the EIA CART is focusing on the solution space when designing a trans-European system. The EIA action has four main objectives, which are presented in these slides. The objectives of the EIA action explain how the EIRA and the EIA CART can be used by public administrations in the Member States to improve interoperability. So the EIRA and the EIA CART can be used to accelerate the design of systems that support the delivery of interoperable digital public services across borders and sectors. It can be used for assessing, meaning for comparing existing architectures in different policy domains and thematic areas, for communicating and sharing, meaning for documenting the most silent interoperability elements of complex systems, and for reusing, meaning to discover and reuse interoperability solutions, existing interoperability solutions, through the use of the European Interoperability Cartography. In this slide, we present the use cases of the EIA action. The use cases are grouped according to the objectives that we presented in the previous slide. For the designing objectives, the work products of the EIA action can be used to design solution architectures and design reference architecture. For the assessing side, they can be used for comparing reference architecture and solution architectures, and can be used by portfolio managers to rationalize and manage the IT portfolio of their applications. For the communication side, the EIRA and the EIA CART can be used to structure the architectural implication of a policy or thematic domain, and then communicate to the stakeholders the architecture of a policy or a thematic domain, and to document interoperability solutions. Finally, the cartography can be used to search for existing interoperability solutions. In this section, I will present the user story, which explains how the use cases can be mapped in reality. In this user story, we present the fictional story of Marco Rinaldi. Marco Rinaldi is an enterprise architect that is working in the social security sector for a public administration in Italy. His organization has to be compliant with the new European directive and has the mandate to build new information systems that enable automatic exchange of social security information with the Commission and other public administrations in Europe. So, what is the challenge of Marco Rinaldi? He must ensure interoperability between national systems and the systems of the European Commission and other member states. How can then he use the work products of the EIA action? He can use the technical view application of the European Interoperability Reference Architecture to find the building blocks that are relevant for interoperable message exchange. Once he has found these building blocks and he has designed its architecture, he can use the European Interoperability Cartography to find solutions that are mapping to these building blocks. The key benefits that we see in doing such exercise is a strong focus on a cross-border interoperability from the outset of the project, a faster access to reusable solutions, and alignment to a common reference model, the European Interoperability Reference Architecture indeed. In this section, I'm going to present the European Interoperability Reference Architecture in detail. The European Interoperability Reference Architecture is divided into five main views, which are created according to the European Interoperability Framework. You will see that the views of the EIRA are one-to-one mapped to the layers of the European Interoperability Framework. So the reference architecture is divided into a legal, organizational, semantic, and technical view. The technical view is divided then in application and infrastructure. The vertical layer that you see is the political context view. The political context view models the most silent building blocks expressing the motivation or intentions leading to the definition of a public policy. The key building block of this view is the stakeholder and his needs. A stakeholder could be a citizen, a business, or a public administration in Europe. A policy-making body, like the European Commission, intervenes on the need of the stakeholders. How? By defining a policy cycle. The policy cycle produces then a policy and is divided into different sub-steps. The definition of policy objectives, the formulation of policy scenarios, the impact assessment, the policy implementation, and the policy evaluation. General principles are influencing the policy cycle itself. A general principle in the case of European policies could be one of the three or all the three general principles of the EU, like subsidiarity, conferral, and proportionality. But this can be applied also at member state level. The legal view models the most salient public policy development enablers and implementation instruments that shall be considered in order to support legal interoperability in the public policy cycle. In this view, the key building block is the public policy, which is created through the policy cycle, during the policy cycle. A public policy can be at European level, at national level, or at subnational level, and is developed through some enablers, the approach that can be a centralized or decentralized approach, and the mandate, which could be, for example, a strong or weak mandate for the member states to implement the public policy. The public policy itself is then implemented through some implementation instruments, legal instruments and operational instruments. Legal instruments, we can have requirements and constraints. The legal requirements are the legal assets that are mandating the creation of a trans-European system, while the legal constraints are the legal assets that need to be taken into account when developing the trans-European system. For example, a data privacy policy is not mandating, but needs to be taken into account when developing a system. Among the legal assets, the legal instruments, we have binding instruments, like, for example, in the case of European policy, directives or regulations, and non-binding instruments, like recommendations. The last implementation instrument is the operational enabler, like financial resources or implementing guidelines. The organizational view models the most silent building blocks that shall be considered in order to support organizational interoperability among providers and users of a public service. The key building block of this view is the public service, which is provided by a service provider to a user. We have modeled, in this view, several actors. The actors are organizations like business and public administrations, which can have the role of providers and users, and citizens, which are usually users of a public service. We have modeled different interoperability agreements between these actors. An interoperability collaboration agreement is an agreement between providers, between organizations, to collaborate on the delivery of a digital public service. For example, it can be a memorandum of understanding. The interoperability provider agreement is an agreement between providers of the service to agree on how to provide the service to the user. And then the service agreement is the agreement between the user and the provider on how the service is delivered to the user. For example, it can be a service level agreement. The public service is then implemented by a business process. So the business process is the highest building block in the hierarchy that is implementing a public service. The business process is then divided into sub-processes called business information exchange and business transaction, which are accessing the business information entity, any business object that can be treated or managed by a business transaction. The semantic view models the most silent building blocks that shall be considered in order to support semantic interoperability of business information entities processed by a TES. The key building block of this view is the data that is implementing the business information entities, is realizing the business information entity coming from the organizational view. Data can have a representation, like for example an XML representation or an RDF representation of some data. In order to have a representation, we need metadata, meaning data models that are a collection of data entities, reference data like identifier schemas and controlled vocabularies. We have modeled in the semantic view also the policies. We have in the top left corner the data policy. The specific types of data policy are security and privacy policies, licensing and charging policy, and metadata management policy. The technical view application models the most silent business-specific application building blocks that need to be considered in order to support technical interoperability when building an interoperable TES. The technical view application is modeled according to the service-oriented architecture style. So you will see services, the yellow building blocks, and components implementing the services, the blue building blocks. The big group that is including all the building blocks is a trans-European system. This means that a trans-European system is a collection of building blocks, is a collection of applications and services realizing a public service. In the bottom part of the model, we have data source enablers like form management components, record management component, or content management component. These components can be used by processing enablers like mediation enablers, which are the enablers that are used to exchange information, validate, transform, and exchange information with other parties, and decision support enablers like business intelligence services and components. On the upper part, we have workflow enablers that are using the services in the bottom part, like choreography services and orchestration services, which are usually realized by a business process management component. In the upper part, we have the presentation and access enablers. These are the user interfaces and the machine-to-machine interfaces that are provided to human or systems to access the trans-European systems. We see that we have also documentation enablers, because usually trans-European systems are supported, like every other system, by documentation. So we have modeled different type of documentation enablers, like specifications, organizational procedures, or configuration management. We have also included test enablers like test services and test components that are used to test the trans-European system, and administration enablers, which are used to manage the life cycle of the system or to monitor and administer the configuration of the system. The technical view infrastructure models the most salient cross-sectoral infrastructure services, along with the supporting hosting and networking facilities, that shall be considered in order to support technical interoperability when building an interoperable test. The key building block of this view is a trans-European system. A trans-European system can be supported by cross-sectoral infrastructure services, what we call digital services infrastructures. Examples of digital services infrastructure are infrastructure security enablers like e-signature, e-signature validation, identity management, and trust management. These components are indeed cross-sectoral, meaning that they are not business-specific and can be used by all the applications. Other type of digital infrastructure services are the specific purpose enablers, like an e-payment service. Both the trans-European system and the infrastructure services need to be hosted somewhere, deployed somewhere. So they need hosting services and networking services. An hosting service is provided by an hosting facility. For example, a private hosting facility, a private data center, or a cloud hosting facility. Networking services are provided by networks, which can be public or private networks, like Estesta. In this slide, we present the relationship between existing architectures and the European Interoperability Reference Architecture. We believe that an Information Systems Development Reference Architecture, for example, or a National Reference Architecture, can be seen as an instance or a specialization of the European Interoperability Reference Architecture. I am now going to present the positioning of the ERA towards other architecture development resources, which is the last section of my presentation. This slide presents the relationship between the European Interoperability Framework and the European Interoperability Reference Architecture. As you can see, the levels of interoperability in the European Interoperability Framework are mapped one-to-one to the views of the European Interoperability Reference Architecture. So we have legal, organizational, semantic, and technical interoperability, and we have a legal, organizational, semantic, and technical view, which is divided in two views in our reference architecture. In this slide, we can see the positioning of the two main work products of the EIA action, the ERA and the EIA CART, towards other architecture development resources or methodologies. So on the left side, we have the enterprise architecture discipline. The enterprise architecture explains and helps in going from a state A to a state B. On the other end, we have the solution architecture, which is explaining, which is helping how to buy, build, or reuse solutions. We believe that the ERA is in the middle, meaning that helps crossing that bridge, crossing that gap that goes from enterprise architecture to solution architecture by finding the correct building blocks that you need for interoperability, to support interoperability. The EIA CART is on the solution architecture space because it's helping finding solutions, concrete existing solutions that can be used to design your solution architecture. In this slide, we present the approach that we have for the endorsement of the AERA from the member states. So on the 25th of April, you will have access to the supporting material, the podcast that now I am presenting, and the presentation deck with the description of the building blocks. On the 7th of May, we will be pleased to receive your feedback. So please send us your question and feedback to the EIA functional mailbox. In case you need further information, we can also organize a conference call to discuss with you any questions you might have on the AERA and the EIA card. On the 13th of May, we will release a new version of the European Interoperability Reference Architecture, implementing your comments. On the 19th of May, we will present the new version of the European Interoperability Reference Architecture to the ISA Working Group. Thank you very much.